I have to show you this beautiful binding. A wonderful poet, Sam Green, and his wife, also a poet, Sally, they run a bindery and printery on Waldron Island and the Pacific Northwest off the coast of Washington. And Sally prints that book on a treadle press, an old-fashioned platen treadle press, and Sam does the bindings and send. They make their own marbled papers as well. And since we've been friends, they've developed this lovely custom that when you have a book out, you send a copy to Sam, and he sends it back in one of these beautiful handmade bindings, you know. It's keeping a lost art going. I suppose if it's still going, it's hardly a lost art, is it? Yeah. Walter Benjamin writes about the angel of history, and I suppose it's instructive to say that, sometimes a title will stay with you and find another use entirely. This has nothing to do with the subject matter of Benjamin's essays, but it's just, I liked the title. And sometimes a poem will simply start from a title. It'll start from a phrase, a small verbal nucleus, maybe a rhythm. But this poem started with the idea that they're not getting away with it. Our rulers are not getting away with it. The merciless eye of history is on them. And I suppose it's repositioning also the idea of the recording angel, which Sister Angela and High Infants beat into us. And nothing is hidden, everything is written down. And so this is, the standpoint of the poem, I should say, is on the portico of the National Library, which is one of my favorite places in the world, because if you stand on the steps of the National Library, you can watch our rulers going back and forth behind bars. And it's somehow vague, very cheering. So this is the angel of history. In the Parliament House on Kildare Street, the lamps were burning. It was a winter night, the usual slant rain falling. I had paused to light up a cigarette, to watch the lone guard stamp her feet blow uselessly into her cupped, gloved hands. In the colonnade of the National Library, a man was standing, a man neither old nor young, his head bare, half turned towards the lights in the Parliament House, the high blank windows. I saw him reach inside his long loose coat, take out a notebook. I crossed the road, gathering my own long coat around me, stood in behind him and looked over his shoulder. He paid no heed. One after another, I saw him strike them out from a long list of names, senators, deputies, ministers. One after another, the names dissolved on the page, a scant dozen remaining. I watched him ink in a question mark after each of these, neat and precise. He put the book away, sliding it down carefully into a deep pocket. He turned and looked at me, nothing like pity in those hollow eyes. He sighed, then squared his shoulders, lifted his face to the rain, and was gone. Gone as if he had never been. But I saw him. I know who he was. I witnessed that cold, exact cancellation. Walked on. Walked home. Thoughtful. Afraid for my country.